Hey, what's up guys, OSG back. Okay, so with the upcoming release of the A500 Mini, a lot of people are saying it's not for me, but I'd buy the Maxi if it was to be released. Retro Games Ltd, who makes the A500 Mini, has hinted that the concept of a Maxi would depend on the sales of the Mini. So if the attitude is to not buy the Mini and wait for the Maxi, then this will probably not happen. In this video, we will look at a number of pros and cons to the Maxi coming to fruition, and in the end, I'll give my opinion on whether I think it will happen or not. Right, so let's start by looking at the Mini. Way back in August last year, the A500 Mini was announced, and even back then they said it would be bundled with 25 games. Which for an early announcement was a little disappointing. Since then, the lineup has been announced, and although it's a great bunch of games, it's missing some Amiga staples like SWAS, Cannon Fodder, etc. This ain't such a big thing though, as everyone knows we can add our own games. It comes with a USB tank style mouse and controller, much like the CD32 controller. The biggest issue most people have is a fixed, no use keyboard, which makes a Mini, in essence, a super expensive Raspberry Pi case, although this won't have a Pi in it. And then, there's the price. It's £119, which makes this the most expensive Mini to date. Hell, it's even more expensive than the two Maxis that Retro Games Ltd have released. To get an understanding where it stands in the market, we need to go right back to 2016 when the first official Mini console was released from Nintendo. The NES Classic Mini took the retro community by storm, as up until this point we had only had cheap knockoffs that weren't licensed and really, as far as the collectors were concerned, they weren't worth buying. But here we had the real thing from a real company. The Mini was a scaled down version of the NES. Well, in looks anyway, as there was no functionality to the case at all, apart from to house the board. The NES Classic Mini had 30 great NES titles on, which to be honest wasn't great, as it's Nintendo making it, so licensing shouldn't have been a problem, and the whole of the NES library is under a gig in size. A year later in 2017, following the success of the NES Classic Mini, the SNES Classic Mini was released. Although basically the same as the NES Classic Mini in size and packaging, this Mini somehow demanded a £20 increase in the price and came in at £69.99, which is something I don't understand, especially as the SNES Mini only had 21 games on. This set a new precedent for Mini pricing, and the following three Minis, the C64 Mini, PlayStation Classic and Mega Drive Mini, were all released under the same price tag. At this point, I should mention that none of these consoles came with the ability to add new games, although through the wonders of exploits and firmware updates, it is possible. 2 months after the Mega Drive Mini, the first Maxi console was released, and this was down to the massive popularity of the Retro Games Ltd C64 Mini, and also a massive demand and outcry about the Mini not being a fully functional system. I mean, yeah, you can get away with consoles, but really, a computer needs to have a functioning keyboard at least. The C64 was a full-scale replica of the original C64 bread bin, with a fully working keyboard and also weight, which was provided by a steel plate inside the system that gave it that authentic feel. The Maxi retailed at £109.99, which was a 36% markup on the Mini, but really when you think about how much extra you got with the size and fully working keyboard, I think that £109.99 was a great price. 6 months after the C64, we got the TurboGrafx-16 Mini, and this is where the Minis got expensive, as Konami decided to buck the price trend and push this out at the same price as the C64, which although it's a great Mini, maybe the best of them in fact, it's still too much for what it is, even though it had 59 games installed as stock. Later that year, some 1 year after the C64 Maxi, Retro Games Ltd released the VIC-20 for the same price as the C64 Maxi. The thing is, with the VIC-20, it's basically the same unit as the Maxi, obviously with the VIC-20 colour and badges, so the price is still good and could be done due to the molds etc. being reused, keeping the cost down, as the demand for the VIC-20 was nowhere near that of the C64. Like with the Maxi, it had 64 games installed, but VIC-20 this time, but it was also able to play C64 games too. Okay, so that brings us to the A500 Mini, and the real question that most people want to know. Will the Mini, as in the past, spawn a Maxi? Well, after speaking to Retro Games Ltd, it's definitely not off the table, but really it depends on how many sales the A500 Mini gets. They couldn't confirm just how many pre-orders they have had, but they did give me a collective sales amount of 400k of the C64 range, which I think includes the Mini, Maxi and VIC-20. So without the pre-orders, it's hard to give my opinion on whether I think there will be a Mega Maxi, but being a data man, I can make predictions. So let's look at the facts. The C64 Mini sold enough units to trigger a release of a Maxi, but that Maxi retailed at less than what the A500 Mini is, so going off the C64 Mini at $69.99, and both Maxis were retailed at $109.99, that is a 36% increase. So if we go with that percentage, then the cheapest we would see an Amiga Maxi retail for would be for around £163, when really you could pick up an A600 with a Gore-Tex and hard drive full of games for that, and that's where the problem lies with the Maxi. I think the Mini price is just too high, which will not only result in less sales than the C64 Mini, but also make the Amiga Maxi a step too far price-wise, because really, if you can get the real thing for less, why would you ever buy a Maxi? Okay, so that's it. Whether or not it happens, I know a lot of people would like to get one, but they are more collectors than just casual gamers. Please let me know in the comments below how you feel about the possibility of a Maxi, and what would be the deciding factor, and what price would put you off. Please remember to like this video and subscribe to my channel for more great retro content, and if you would like to support the channel on Patreon like these quality people going up the screen right now, get on over to my Patreon channel where you can pledge for as little as $1. That will get your name in the end credits, video requests and more in the future. Till next time, this is OSG, signing out.